हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज डॉक्टर अशोक कुमार फ्रॉम गवर्नमेंट वुमेन इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज अजमेर। दिस इज लेक्चर वन ऑफ रिफ्लेक्टर एंटीना सीरीज एंड आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द मोस्ट पॉपुलर रिफ्लेक्टर एंटीना विच इज नॉन एज प्राइम फोकस फेड पैराबोलॉइड रिफ्लेक्टर एंटीना। एंड दिस एंटीना वी हैव डिस्कस्ड in lecture 1 of reflector antenna series. The following contents will be addressed during this lecture 1 of reflector antenna series, in which first we need to discuss about the background history, then after the analysis of prime focus fed paraboloid reflector antenna, then aperture efficiency, directivity or gain calculation, half power beam width and Fasnet beam width, and some important design consideration for the prime focus fed paraboloid reflector. The content of this lecture is prepared with the help of these following books. To understand the basic principle of reflector antenna, first we need to know about the theory or basic concept about the aperture antennas, as well as some important analysis that we have discussed in this lecture. So in aperture antenna, we have discussed about the field radiated by the aperture antennas, in which in a free space, in which one parameter 1 plus cos theta term is coming. And second important is the 3 dB bandwidth of radiation pattern in a given plane is determined primarily by the antenna dimension in that plane. Larger the dimension, smaller is the beam width. So we can say second is the beam width, and if the aperture dimension is very large, in that case the beam width is very small. And we can say the aperture area and directivity will holds the relation d is equal to 4 pi ae upon lambda square, where ae is the effective area of the antenna. It is also observed that for a given aperture size, the maximum directivity occurs for a uniform in amplitude as well as phase current distribution over the aperture. So we can say in a uniform current distribution in situation over the aperture, we can calculate the maximum directivity as we have discussed in the aperture antennas. And there are primarily two ways of achieving large aperture for the antenna. In the transmitting mode, we need to generate a nearly in phase current distribution over a area of the large area of the aperture. And in the receiving mode, the power from an incident plane wave from a specific direction should be collected over the same aperture area and added in phase. So we can say we can use in a transmitting mode as well as in a receiving mode. In that case, the important thing we have observed is the in phase current distribution through which we can achieve a large aperture for the antenna. So these are the two primary ways for achieving the large aperture of the antenna. Further, we have discussed about reciprocity theorem, and we know that the transmit and receive properties of antenna are same, and hence we can look at the antenna as a transmitter or as a receiver. So the primary two ways to achieve large aperture, as we have discussed earlier also. So in the form of antennas, how we can achieve? Previously we have discussed in the form of transmitting and receiving mode. In here we are going to discuss about the techniques through which we can achieve the large aperture area, is the using a larger reflector and using an array of small aperture antenna to cover the area. So here we have discussed in this lecture, we have discussed about the category first A, and which is known as the large reflector. But this category we have discussed in the other lecture of a special antenna series, like Yagi Uda antenna, log periodic antenna, or we can say frequency independent antenna, through which we can achieve the large coverage area. But in that case, the size of the antenna is also increases in respective of the directivity. In order to get high directivity, it is not sufficient to make the antenna large, but we also need to maintain a current distribution with near uniform phase over the aperture. One of the simplest way of realizing a large aperture is to use a reflector along with primary feed antenna of much smaller size. So we can say the simplest way to achieve the large aperture area is to use a reflector along with a primary feed antenna of much smaller size, and that primary feed antenna we can say it's a horn antenna. So we can say in the case of a reflector antenna, we need two types of antenna. One is the reflector and other one is the horn antenna. And the categories of various type of reflector antenna, in which some most common are the flat plate reflector, corner reflector, paraboloid reflector, Cassegrain reflector, offset fed paraboloid shaped beam. These are the categories of reflector antenna. Some of them here represented in a geometry figure 1. Here you can see this is the reflector and this is flat plate we can say, or plane reflector. This is the feed and this is the category second called as the corner reflector. Here you can see the angle vary between 0 to 90 or more. You can consider if this angle is a 180 degree, in that case is behave like a plane reflector. This is third category, curved or front end, and this curved is a paraboloid shape, and this is the source through which, and we can call it as the feed, and this is paraboloid reflector, and this is also called the prime focus paraboloid reflector also, and this is the Cassegrain feed, and it is a curved main reflector parabola, and the feed is used in the parabolic reflector, but here you can use the feed as the axis of this parabolic or axis of the reflector antenna at the focal point. So we can achieve the in phase component through which we can achieve the maximum directivity as well as the gain. Here the parabolic focal point on this axis, and this is called as the blockage of the, and this form of the structure we have considered in the case of Cassegrain is the hyperbola, super reflector we can say, and we have discussed these type of reflector antenna in this reflector antenna series one by one. Initially we have discussed about the front end or prime focus paraboloid reflector, then after we have discussed about the Cassegrain feed the prime focus fed paraboloid reflector. What is the basic concept? And this is the most popular used configuration because of its simplicity as well as its advantage. And paraboloid reflector converts spherical wavefronts into a plane wavefront in the aperture plane. As you can see, the best example is the dish antenna we can consider. Here you can see the spherical wavefronts on the reflector we have converted we can concentrate on a horn antenna, and we have converted to the plane wavefront on that aperture. The aperture plane is normally taken as the plane passing through the focal point x is equal to f plane. It means the focal point f where we have located the antenna, horn antenna, or any parallel to the it. In practical antenna, we need to restrict the radiation from the point source to a sector covering only the reflector. Say theta is equal to theta m is the maximum, theta is the variation angle, where theta m is the maximum angle subtended by the reflector at the focal point. So for the practical antenna, this is the important thing that we have under consideration for the designing of the paraboloid reflector antenna, and it is necessary to produce a spherical wavefront with this center coinciding with the focal point of the paraboloid. So we can say the feed antenna, I mean horn antenna, that coinciding with the focal point of the paraboloid. This is generally achieved by the antenna which is known as the horn antenna, which is designed to produce the desired illumination of the reflector. The prime feed is called as it is called as is to so located that its face center coincident with the focal point. This is the important thing that we need to discuss and that we need to keep in mind for the designing of the paraboloid reflector. The face center is derived as a virtual point from which the spherical wavefront appears to. The pattern of the horn is designed to produce the desired illumination amplitude distribution over the aperture after reflection, and the aperture distribution can be obtained from the knowledge of the ray bundle concept, and this is the basic theory that we have discussed in the case of paraboloid reflector. So we need to discuss about the basic principle and their structure of the paraboloid reflector. And we can say the one important thing is that when we are considering the paraboloid, in that case the paraboloid having its excellent ability to produce a pencil beam, I mean high gain with low side lobe and good cross polarization characteristics in the radiation pattern. So this is the important thing that we have observed in the case of paraboloid reflector. And here we have considered the geometry of the paraboloid reflector. This is the paraboloid reflector we have considered, and the primary feed, this is called as the primary feed, produces spherical wave fronts which after reflection is transformed to a plane waveform. You can see this is the wave incident on the reflector, that we have transformed this wave at the focal point into the plane wave fronts. And let the intensity pattern of the feed horn, this is the intensity that we have considered, g theta comma phi is the intensity of the feed horn. So the total power radiated in any elemental solid angle d rho and d phi after reflection illuminate to the projection elemental area on the aperture rho d rho and d phi. This is rho d rho and d phi. So we can say we can equate these two basic concept g theta comma phi into sine of theta d theta and d phi equal to, this is the power this is the pattern, and this is pattern is known as the aperture power density distribution p of theta into rho d rho and d phi. So this area is equal to the this intensity pattern, and where rho is the radial coordinate of any point on the aperture that we need to discuss. And after that, from the geometry of the paraboloid, we can also say r sine theta. You can say this is theta, this is r cos theta, and this is r sine theta, and r sine theta is equal to rho here you can see. And the equation of the paraboloid can be calculated by using this Fick configuration. We have considered this is the focal point, and this is the largest dimension of the reflector. Then the ray from the source, I mean focal point, to the at any point on the reflector and transformed into the parallel lines. In that case, we can calculate, and which is equal to twice of f. We can say by using this concept we can calculate the paraboloid equation, that is equal to r is equal to 2f over 1 plus cos theta is equal to f sec square theta by 2. Combining these two equation, this r value and this equation, we can combine, then we can calculate twice of f sine of theta upon 1 plus cos theta. So we can simply say we are putting the value of r into the equation 2, then we can calculate the value of rho, and this is the value of rho. Here you can see this is a small incremental length, and differentiating rho by using d theta, by using the angle theta, and this is the angle theta from at the horn feed, primary feed, d rho upon d theta is equal to 2f upon 1 plus cos theta. Then substituting equation 5 into equation 1, so we can get p rho comma phi is equal to g. So we can say the power pattern p rho comma theta is dependent on the g 1 plus cos theta ka square upon 4 pi 4 f square. F is the focal length, cos theta, so this is the multiplication term that it observed in the prime focus. फेड पैराबोलॉइड रिफ्लेक्टर. सो वी कैन से द करंट द फील्ड डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड ओवर ऑन द सरफेस इज नॉट यूनिफॉर्म बिकॉज इट कम्स विद द फैक्टर 1 प्लस कॉस थीटा के स्क्वायर अपॉन 4 पाई एफ स्क्वायर. सो इट इज इजी टू ट्रांसफॉर्म द प्राइमरी हॉर्न पैटर्न इनटू द अपर्चर डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन यूजिंग इक्वेशन 6. A 2D Fourier transform of the distribution give us the field intensity pattern. Square of the field intensity pattern is the power pattern. Because of the cylindrical coordinates assumed for the circular aperture, we need to use the 2D Fourier transform in the popular form to compute the radiation pattern of the paraboloid reflector. So we can say, we can generally use Fourier transform of this equation, then after we can calculate the field pattern. These are some important efficiency and other parameter that affect the aperture efficiency of the prime focus paraboloid reflector, in which these are one by one we have discussed about these parameters, and by these parameters is also affected the directivity, gain and other parameters of the paraboloid reflector. So here we have discussed about first the illumination taper efficiency, which is represented kappa t, and often used in the concept of reflector antenna. This is measure of how well we are able to produce a uniform distribution on the aperture. We know that the directivity is maximum if the aperture illumination is uniform and is equal to the pi d by lambda k square for the circular of diameter d. With a conventional horn antenna as a primary feed, the illumination at the edge taper off compared to that of the center of the paraboloid. So it is evident of the equation 6 that it is difficult to obtain a uniform distribution or uniform illumination because of the 1 plus cos theta ka square upon 4 pi f square term exists in equation 6. So we can say it is difficult to obtain a uniform illumination. If the aperture distribution is not uniform, we can define the illumination taper efficiency, and which is known as the ratio of the integral of the normalized aperture distribution to the aperture area. So this is the important that we need to discuss in the case of a reflector antennas. And this is the second, which is known as the spillover loss as well as spillover frequency. If the primary reflector attains a maximum substandard angle theta m at the focus, the power radiated by the primary horn is not fully utilized in illuminating the reflector. So the primary horn radiate outside the region theta greater than theta m is not intercepted by the reflector. In that case, the loss of power, apart from producing some radiation on the back side of the reflector, also affects overall gain of the antenna. This is called as spillover loss. So we can say from this region theta greater than theta m, which is not intercepted by the reflector, and due to this the spillover loss is exist, and it is called spillover loss. And the ratio of the power intercepted by the reflector and the total power radiated by the feed horn is normally called the spillover frequency, and which is represented by kappa of S. S represents the spillover, K kappa is the spillover frequency. So we can say the power intercepted by the reflector and the total power radiated by the feed horn. In addition to reducing the gain of the antenna, the spillover loss also increases and the noise temperature of the antenna. This is another important thing. If the spillover part of the primary horn pattern is directed towards the earth, and this is the aperture blockage, and this is the third important parameter that we need to discuss in the case of reflector antennas. As we have seen from the figure 2, there the reflector from the vertex region of the paraboloid is blocked by the primary horn itself and does not reach the aperture plane. This is known as the aperture block. This power reflected into the primary horn appears as the input reflection or a mismatch at the input. So due to the block aperture blockage, The aperture distribution has a zero intensity region approximately equal to the projected area of the feed on the aperture plane. So we can say due to the aperture blockage that exists in the reflector antenna, we have found out the important drawback, that is due to the aperture blockage, the directivity we have reduced, as well as the side lobe level is also increased. And this is the basic or prime drawbacks of the front end paraboloid or prime focus fed paraboloid reflector. So the blockage is normally taken care of by making the aperture distribution P rho comma phi 0 in this region, where P rho b is the max, where rho b is the radius of the blocked area. So we have considered in a proper manner and the aperture distribution in this range, so we can achieve the maximum directivity as well as gain and minimum side lobe level. The fourth is the polarization efficiency factor, and we have represented by kappa of x, and it is called as the power radiated in the cross polar pattern of the antenna is essentially the loss of the system and can be considered as the reduction in the gain of the antenna. As we can say, suppose the antenna is vertically polarized, in that case the horizontal polarized component is called as the cross polar component. Similarly, in the case of suppose the antenna is left LSCP, left handed circularly polarized, in that case their cross polar component is right handed circularly polarized component. So the power loss in the cross polar component is called as the loss of the system, and it is measured we have in terms of polarization efficiency factor. And fifth is the phase efficiency factor, which is represented by the kappa of E, and this is phase errors over the aperture. The deviation from the spherical wavefronts can cause non-uniform phase variation over the aperture after reflection from the paraboloid, and it is also reduce the directivity loss as well as uniformity of the plane over the aperture. And the sixth important is the surface irregularities of the reflector surface that cause in the loss of gain, and this can be we have measured in terms of random error efficiency, and we have represented kappa of R. So we can say what we can calculate the overall aperture efficiency, which is the product of these six efficiencies: illumination, taper, efficiency, spillover, blockage, polarization, and phase. And we have to multiply these efficiencies, then after we can calculate the overall aperture efficiency. If the overall aperture efficiency is known, in that case directivity we can calculate, and directivity d is equal to 4 pi upon lambda square, ae is the effective area, which is equal to 4 pi upon lambda square, neta ap is the aperture efficiency, ap is the physical area of the paraboloid reflector. And the value of aperture efficiency depending on the illumination chosen, but we can say the overall aperture efficiency lies between 60 to 85%. If we need to calculate the antenna gain, sometimes it is called as the power gain, and in that case we have considered a lossless antenna and tapered illumination with the circular aperture paraboloid reflector according to figure 2, as we have discussed. This is the maximum directivity, and this is the focal, and this is the paraboloid reflector we have considered. It is considered as a circular. In that case we can calculate the physical area with AP is equal to pi d square upon 4. D is the diameter of the reflector. And by considering the equation 7 directivity and equation 8 AP, we can calculate the GP. GP is equal to neta into D, where neta we have considered is the product of the radiation efficiency as well as illumination efficiency, and we have considered radiation efficiency neta is equal to 100%. In that case, we can calculate the power gain, which is dependent on the netaipi as well as the overall physical area. And we have considered the illumination efficiency netaip is equal to 0.8, I mean 65% for the dipole feed, or we can say non-directional radiation characteristics feed. In that case, this equation 9 can be reduced as gp is equal to 6.41 d by lambda ka whole square. This is very very important equation that needs to be required for the calculation of different types of problem based on the paraboloid reflector or prime focus or front end paraboloid reflector. So this is very very important, but this equation is holds only for the dipole feed having the aperture illumination efficiency neta ip is equal to 0.65. sometimes it's saying aperture efficiency also. If the value of neta ip is given different, in that case we have considered this formula for calculating the power gain or antenna gain in the case of reflector antenna. And the half power beamwidth can be estimated by the rule of thumb, and this is the half power beamwidth, which is equal to 70 into lambda by d in the form of degree. And this formula is slightly different for the half power beamwidth we have calculated in the case of uniform distribution on the aperture antennas, and here we have discussed about the non-uniform distribution on the reflector antenna, which is equal to 70 into lambda by d. And these are some important design consideration, how we can design this such type of antenna. So there is a trade-off required because to make the distribution near uniform, it is become necessary to be a broader beam width for a horn, so that the part of the pattern with the maximum angular sector theta m subtended by the reflector a broader primary horn pattern results in a smaller horn, which is beneficial in reducing aperture blockage, but the broader pattern increases the spillover loss. Thus a compromise is generally required in the design of the feed horn. So we can say for the design consideration, the feed horn is very very important, and there is a trade-off required between the the current distribution, uniform current distribution on the aperture as well as the spillover loss. The second point is the focal length f by d, focal length to diameter ratio, and this can be reduce the cross polar radiation from the reflector. And other ways to minimize the cross polar radiation is to have the large f by d ratio, so the curvature of the paraboloid is small. So we can say for the design consideration, trade-off is required between the for the designing of the feed horn as well as the focal length to the diameter ratio. These are the two important factors that needs to be required for the design of the reflector antennas. Here we have considered one example, and this example is based on the paraboloid reflector, and here it is given is the non-directional, so we can consider it's a dipole feed and illumination efficiency is the 65%. These parameters are given, we need to calculate these parameters. Here first step we can calculate the wavelength, in the second step we can calculate the power gain, which is equal to defined in the equation 10 for 6.41 d by lambda k square, which is equal to 1024000, which is equal to 60.103 dB. And we can calculate the half power beamwidth, which is equal to 70 into lambda by d, where in terms of degree, which is equal to 0.175. calculate the beamwidth, we have to multiply the equation 11 by a factor 2, or we can use the half power beamwidth is equal to beamwidth within first null divided by 2. So beamwidth within first null is equal to 2 into half power beamwidth, which is equal to we have to multiply this by using this factor 2, or we equation by 2, then we can get 140 into lambda by d in terms of degree. These are the two another problem, and in this problem we need to calculate the diameter as well as the beam width in the case of problem 2. And in the problem 3 you need to calculate the beam width, directivity and capture area. And capture area is also called in the case of reflector antenna is a effective area. And these two problems are to test yourself how we can solve this problem based on the previous theory that we have discussed in this lecture 1. Thank you everyone for watching this lecture. I hope this lecture is beneficial for you.